and the animals are safer. And so I invite you to place your feet firmly on the ground and imagine a place on this land that you love. Here in this place, we give thanks to our Creator for this land and its first peoples, who cared for it long before the settlers arrived. Pemina Parish gathers on the traditional land of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Dakota, Dene, the Anishinaabe nations, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. Each time that we speak these words, we recommit ourselves to learning about the land and its first peoples, past and present, and to developing reconciled relationships. In the power of the Spirit, may it be so.
Let us receive this Mi'kmaq welcoming song sung by Joni Shawana and Sandra Campbell.
From deep soil comes bold and daring growth. From the seeds of our past will come fresh new growth.
We come today to marvel at what has been harvested and prepare for what will come.
We come to celebrate where we are and where we have been. We come rejoicing with our ancestors in faith across generations.
The Methodists, Congregationalists, and Presbyterians,
the Evangelical United Brethren and local union churches, and our full communion partners across this world.
The Presbyterian Church in the Republic of Korea.
The United Church of Christ.
The United Church of Christ in the Philippines.
And the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ.
We give thanks to God for the blessings of past, present, and future, and dare to plant these seeds of faith anew.
We're going to join in singing Voice of the United 820, Make a Joyful Noise, which is a paraphrase of Psalm 100. And in doing so, we join our voices with our spiritual ancestors who sang another paraphrase of this psalm as an introit to the United Church of Canada Union Service back in 1925. Let us sing together.
Make a joyful noise. make a joyful noise, O earth. Worship your God with gladness. Make a joyful noise, O earth. Come to this place with a song. Bend to these gifts thanksgiving. Bend to these chords with praise.
Let us pray. Again and again, God, we come to this time and place with a song. Each day you give us a chance to begin anew, to drink deeply of your Spirit, to boldly follow in the way of Jesus, and to dare to seek justice as we seek relationship with our neighbors and with you. Again and again, God, you call us out of our old lives and into your new day. And so, as we celebrate the 99th anniversary of this United Church of yours, help us to reflect back with clarity upon all that deserves to be celebrated, all that deserves to be lamented, and all that deserves to be let go. We are not perfect, God, but we are yours, and we trust that you are with us every day. This day and always, help us to be good grain that is planted and tended by your love, so that in the year to come we may flourish in this time and place. Amen. I want to invite all of the kids forward just onto the steps over here for our, it's kind of like a story time / time for all ages. So let's gather over here. Come on down. I want to tell you a story. In 1925, something kind of amazing happened. Do you have a sense of how long ago 1925 is? Just about 100 years, right? Nobody here is quite just about 100 years old. We don't have any, I don't think anyone here is 99, right? Nope, not 99. Your grandpa's 90. Yeah, so he was just a little guy when this happened. So people who believed in God but had different ways of showing it decided that they were going to work together and become one denomination. Do you know what a denomination is? It's kind of a group of churches that all decide to work together. So our denomination is called the United Church of Canada. So back in 1925, there were all these different denominations with lots of different churches, and they thought, why are we not doing this thing together? We should get together and do all of it as one denomination. So lots of different kinds of churches across Canada all came together, and they were really excited. They had their first church service in a big stadium in Toronto. They're excited about what was to come, but they're also sad about the things that they'd be losing, because some of them would have to leave their own buildings and go to another building and be church in that space and with other people. And they were a little bit scared, because a united church like ours had never existed before. We are growing something new, hoping to be like farmers who are sowing seeds of God's love in the world. So today we're celebrating that the United Church is 99 years old. So for almost 100 years, the United Church has been planting seeds. When you have a birthday, I think you probably celebrate how much you've grown and how much you've learned. Do people on your birthday often say, "Oh, you've grown so much"? Yes, yeah, and roll your eyes, exactly. We have grown so much over 100 years. The United Church is very different than it was when it first started. So we want to do the same for our church. We want to celebrate all the things that our church has learned and grown in over 100 years. One thing I celebrate is the ministry of women, which began formally with the ordination of a woman called Lydia Grucci in 1936. Until that point, you couldn't have women ministers. But she was so determined to serve God, and the church was willing to change, they made it possible for women to become leaders in the United Church of Canada. Can anyone think of things that they would want to celebrate about our church or about the United Church of Canada? What would you want to celebrate? Are there things you like about our church? There are things we like about our church. We could think about this. We have a whole year to think about what kinds of things we would want to celebrate about our church and about the United Church of Canada. Do you know, anniversaries and birthdays sometimes are opportunities that we celebrate how we've grown really well, but it's also a time that we remember things we might want to do differently when we go forward. So we admit that there are times when we did things that were wrong in God's name, that were maybe hurtful or harmful. And we also admit there are times we didn't do things that we probably should have. When we do that kind of thing in church, it's called confession. It's one way of apologizing for what we've done and asking God to help us fix relationships and to help us do better going forward. So today, we're going to make some room for new things to grow. Do you see our flower pots here? We're going to make some room to grow things in these flower pots, but right now they're filled with some rocks. And big old rocks don't grow things very well. So we're going to remove some rocks from the soil of our future. And we're going to begin by speaking some words to each other. And your part, all of you, your part is going to be, "Let us make room for love." Can we practice that? Let us make room for love. All right. So we'll start with our litany, and then we'll get to the stones part after that. Loving God, in the fields of our lives and the life of our church, not all of the ground is ready to receive your seeds of hope. Let us make room for love. There are many places where the soil is so rocky that the good life you intended is choked.
Let us make room for love.
As we prepare for your new seeds, help us to clear the rocks and tend the ground on which we live. Now receive our silent prayers as we confess our words and actions and attitudes that have harmed your good ground. Let's pray in silence for a few moments. God, today we want to name some of the obstacles that have kept the seeds of love from flourishing in our church. And after each one of these, Kylie and Leah and Annalie are going to put a rock onto the table as we make room for love. Stones of fear and hatred. When we have taught hate instead of love, can you give it to Kylie? Okay, stones of injustice and evil. Can you pick another stone? When we have oppressed other people, stones of silence and ignorance. When we have not boldly denounced injustice, stones of pride and arrogance. Can Leah grab that one? It's really heavy. When we have prioritized power and possessions over the gospel and of people, when we have relied on ourselves and our own understandings, failing to live in community as the body of Christ. And finally, stones of disrespect and cruelty. Who's going to carry that one? That's a big stone. There we go. When we have failed to reconcile and be in good relations with the earth and with each other. As we reflect on this pile of stones, may they serve as a marker of where we have been, a remembrance of the things we wish to change, and a signpost for the direction in which we wish to travel together further. Gracious God, allow the fields of our hearts and lives to be gardens of your new hope and love. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can wait here for a second. We're going to hear a musical reflection by Joni Shawana and Sandra Campbell again. Faced with this cairn of stones, marking where we have been, may we remember, dear siblings, that God is slow to anger and full of compassion, abounding in love. God offers forgiveness to all who humbly repent. Let us be confident of this. The great gardener who began a good work in us will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God. We're going to join our voices in singing Voice United 703 in the Bulb There Is a Flower. Thank you. Let us seek wisdom in the scriptures. May it be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Nancy will share our readings today.
Our readings from the Jewish scriptures today is from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 16 to 21. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters? Who brings out a chariot and horse, army and warrior? They lay down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider things of old. I am about to do new things. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way with the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. I will give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. I give drink to my chosen people, the people who I'm formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. Our gospel reading today is from John chapter 12, verses 20 to 28. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, The hour has come for the child of earth to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who live their lives, who love their life, lose it. And those who hate their lives in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Creator will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Creator, save me from this hour? No, it is for this season that I have come to this hour. Creator, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. Here lies wisdom. Thanks be to God.
We'll now hear the message from our United Church moderator, the Right Reverend Dr. Carmen Lansdowne. At Toronto Metropolitan United, the second scripture reading was offered in Mohawk by Samantha Pippin, so you'll hear Reverend Lansdowne offer thanks for that reading as she begins her message.
Samantha, Wallace Gayasacha to you, and also Wallace Gayasacha to your grandpa Satewas for his beautiful translation. Of finishing the translation of the Bible into Mohawk. Friends, I have adopted the practice in recent months of describing how I show up when I preach or speak in public. Part of living into being an intentionally intercultural church is to always remain open to transformation by the presence of those not like me. Last year, I was transformed by theologian Ann Kinney, whose book, My Body is Not a Prayer Request, Disability Justice in the Church. I know many of you have read and studied that book across the church. I had the pleasure of taking the stage alongside Anne as a speaker at the 2023 Evolving Faith Conference in Minneapolis. She described how she was physically showing up so that those who were blind or sight impaired might have a more fulsome experience gathering together as church. So, I am approximately 5'9", although I used to be 5'10", I think I've lost an inch to sitting too much at desks as an adult. I have ear-length dark brown hair, increasingly graying. It's straight and in an asymmetrical haircut. Chunky, square-shaped glasses, which, together with the church, I'm trying to discern if they're purple, blue, or somewhere in between. I'm wearing my white alb, which I dry cleaned especially for the occasion, and I'm wearing a beautiful stole. You'll see many of us that are involved in the service today are wearing matching stoles in celebration of this kickoff service for our centennial that was made by the amazing Susie Henderson. They are on beautiful bright red backgrounds with our United Church crest at the bottom right side and the 100th anniversary logo on the bottom left. On the right side in yellow text are the words deep, bold, daring. Et sur le côté gauche se trouvent les mots profonde, dynamique et audacieuse. Four ribbons of color swirl down from the left shoulder over both sides of the stole. Three of the ribbons are black, white, and yellow. The other three colors of the medicine wheel. The fourth, she has incorporated fabric that symbolizes the heritage of the stole wearer. So my fourth ribbon is red with shell buttons sewn along it to represent the button blankets of the Heuschoch people and other coastal peoples in British Columbia. Also, at the most recent meeting of the Pacific Mountain Regional Council, the Youth Council proposed a motion that the moderator have an annual budget for vibrant, flashy shoes. And the Affirm United folks in the region proposed an amendment that perhaps in order to ensure excellence and taste, that those shoes needed to pass through a queer eye filter. When I first became moderator, I told the youth of this church that no matter what they asked of me, if it was humanly possible, I would try and be there for them. So knowing it was a joke, I bought myself my own pair of vibrant, flashy shoes from the now famous East Vancouver shoe designer John Fluvog. They're low-heeled, white patent, crocodile-textured leather Mary Janes with orange and yellow splatters on them, violet soles that match my glasses, and an orange strap with an orange and violet buckle. Someone from the community of faith that sponsored me for ministry reached out to inform me that each pair of Fluvogs has soul talk inscribed on the soles, and they're all limited edition shoes, and so each version of the shoe has different words inscribed on the bottom. So when I arrived in Toronto from St. John's this morning, I grabbed them out of the closet, and these are the four words that are inscribed on the bottom. Watching, listening, signs, wonders. Now, if those aren't vibrant, flashy shoes made for a moderator, I don't know what are. I'm also wearing lipstick so that those of you who might be hard of hearing have an easier time lip reading. And I preach from full text so we can make my sermon available if you don't catch everything. Je parlerai principalement en anglais avec seulement un petit peu de français. Je crois que nous prévoyons de faire traduire mon homélie en français. And if you would like a copy for translation to other languages, we can make it available also. I say that I was transformed by Ann Kinney because it only takes a few moments to show up differently for each other, to live for each other. And I feel like a much better moderator, much better preacher, and much better human for starting my talks this way. Friends, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your eyes. And may I never lightly presume to preach your word, and may we never lightly presume to hear your word, for in your word is abundant life. Amen. We believe in the one only living and true God, a spirit infinite, eternal, and unchangeable, in the God's self-being and perfections, the Lord Almighty, who is love, most just in all ways, most glorious in holiness, unsearchable in wisdom, plenteous in mercy, full of compassion and abundant goodness and truth. We worship Creator in the unity of the Godhead and the mystery of the Holy Trinity. God who is love, the Christ, love incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, love's power. Three persons of the same substance, equal in power and glory. These are the first words of our Articles of Faith in the United Church of Canada. They go on, we believe that God has revealed God's self in nature, in history, and in the heart of humanity, that God has been graciously pleased to make clearer revelation of God's self to people of God who spoke as if they were moved by the Holy Spirit, and that in the fullness of time, God has been perfectly revealed in Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, who is the brightness of the glory of the divine and the express image of God's self. We receive the Holy Scriptures of the Hebrew texts and the New Testaments, given by inspiration of God as containing the only infallible rule of faith and life, a faithful record of God's gracious revelations and as sure witness to Christ. We believe that the eternal, wise, holy, and loving purpose of God so embraces all events that while the freedom of humans is not taken away, nor is God the author of our sin, yet in God's providence, God makes all things work together in the fulfillment of Creator's sovereign design and the manifestation of God's glory. Church, surely that eternal, wise, holy, and loving purpose of God does embrace all events, and that means that surely the Holy One, Holy Three, are here with us today as always. In this time and this place, as we gather together along with the denominations, communities of faith, presbyteries, and councils of the past 99 years to count the seeds that together we have planted along the way. L'Église est une communauté de personnes possédant des dons variés. Unis par le Saint-Esprit, nous sommes assemblés pour célébrer la présence de Dieu, pour discerner la vérité de Dieu et pour marcher sur le chemin de Jésus. Par notre baptême, nous devenons membres de l'Église du Christ. Nous vivons cette appartenance au sein d'une confession chrétienne à laquelle nous appartenons pour nous, l'Église unie du Canada. The Church is a community of people with varied gifts, united by the Spirit. We gather to celebrate God's presence, to discern God's truth, and to follow the way of Jesus. By our baptism, we are made members of Christ's church. We exercise this membership in the denomination to which we belong, which for us is the United Church of Canada. Samuel Dwight Chown became the general superintendent of the Methodist Church in Canada in 1910. He was a champion of the social gospel and of church union, and later became known as the architect of our church union. Professors Don Schweitzer and the Reverend Dr. Hyeran Kim Craig have pulled together a beautifully rich volume on the history of the first 100 years of preaching in the United Church of Canada, which is in the final processes of publication. I got an advanced opportunity to read the book because I wrote the foreword. It's good to be the moderator. And in it, they included a sermon that Chown preached in 1912 to a Methodist gathering. And when I read his sermon, I thought, I could basically take this sermon and change very little. I could preach it today, and I would still be speaking God's word to us about the changing times in which we find ourselves. Since I started my own sermon with the first three articles of our faith, I wanted to share with you an important excerpt from that sermon. Chown wrote, at the very first meeting of the Church Union Committee, I suggested that we should sit down first and decide what the Church of Christ was, or what the Church of Christ was in the world for, and to do this to the satisfaction of all parties. Next, we should decide what is necessary to be believed to enable the Church to do its God-appointed work. After that, we should permit all other questions to be viewed by the people as they might choose in the full exercise of personal liberty. I still think we shall have to approach this ideal. The idea seemed to take the committee for a time, But soon the old creedal instinct asserted itself, and the dear brethren, and they were all brethren, settled down to the formulation of a scientific creed, and I sat and admired their dexterity, but had comparatively small interest in the result. The theology of the basis of union never caused the members of the committee very serious concern. Matters of administration were much more difficult to handle. The result is a good, workable creed, quite conservative in spirit, but a creed the whole of which no one member of the committee believes. For while each article was carried by a majority vote, no single member voted for every article of it. We have also a creed which may have as many meanings as there are people who say they believe it, which is a very happy circumstance because it accords with the original purpose of creeds, which was not to control the faith of the individual, but to express their untrammeled convictions. Our gospel text this afternoon tells us, "The hour has come for the child of earth to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Creator will honor." What more beautiful expression than grains of wheat falling into the earth and dying to bear fruit, than the committee of faithful, discerning people who wrote our articles of faith? And from the prophet Isaiah, "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" Chown said, "The result is a creed the whole of which no one member of the committee believes. For while each article was carried by majority vote, no single member voted for every article. We have also a creed which may have as many meanings as there are people who say they believe it, which is a very happy circumstance, because it accords with the original purpose of creeds, which was not to control the faith of the individual, but to express his untrammeled convictions." And there is no way, not in 1890, 1910, 1912, or 1925, that Chown or anyone else would really be able to predict this beautifully diverse church of deep spirituality, bold discipleship, and daring justice, that our church founders had the foresight and vision to know that we would need new expressions of our faith and that our basis of union would include the possibility for each generation of the church to express again its faith anew, which we did in the Statement of Faith in 1940, a new creed in 1968, and a Song of Faith in 2006. Together, we hold beliefs that may have as many meanings as there are people who say that they believe them. What a beautiful tradition we have in this united and uniting church of ours. This next year will be a time of commemoration to recognize and honor all of the legacies of our first 100 years together as the United Church of Canada. So many, but not all, of those legacies are good. And one of the things I love about our church, the thing that makes me stand here in this pulpit today and in pulpits across the church from coast to coast to coast, as a woman, as an Indigenous woman, and as the granddaughter of a residential school survivor, the things that allow me to claim any conviction or faith at all is expressed so perfectly in John's gospel. And Jesus said, "Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Creator, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Creator, glorify your name." Just because we are troubled by current and past circumstance is no reason to stop following in the ways of Christ or to stop striving to be the church in Christian community with and for each other. I take great comfort, and I hope so will you, that never has the church fully or perfectly known how to become the revelation of God's love for the world. Our journey has proven, both in spite and because of God's redeeming grace, that our human tendency to sin, to oppression, to domination of the other, can never be the full expression of what it is the divine intention for us being in Christian community. God is always saying to us, "Look, I am doing a new thing. Can you not perceive it?" God is always calling us to set aside our human fallibility and make space for each other, to make space for love. No matter what the future holds for this united church of ours, I know that it will not be perfect, just as the first 100 years were also not perfect. But I know the ways in which we look for God's promise and the ways that we come through the hard parts of life in Jesus' footsteps are all to the glory of God's holy name. And so I want to end with an adaptation of part of a prayer by the late Trappist monk Thomas Merton. O God, we believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and we hope that we have that desire in all that we are doing. We hope that we will never do anything apart from that desire. And we know that if we do this, you will lead us by the right road, though we may know nothing about it. You call us, sometimes loudly, sometimes in soft whispers, to make room for love. May it be so. Amen.
Let us respond to the inspirational words we've heard from Carmen by speaking a new creed together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us join our voices in our song of response this morning, which is More Voices 174, Soil of God, You and I.
Open to everyone. For living in harmony, for here God is found. All stand together, this is holy ground.
As you can see, our kids were very busy while we were listening to our message. They've created two planters, one for here at St. Paul's and one for Zion Calvin, for us to celebrate the 99th anniversary of the United Church of Canada. So thank you to all of our kids this morning. We want to continue in prayer for the church this morning, so I invite you to join me in prayer. God of the past, present, and future, from this moment, we are on the threshold. The church is almost, but not yet, 100 years old. As we remember backward to dream forward, help us to go forth to prune, gathering in all that is good and lovely, repairing the damage we find, lamenting that which has died and is dying. Guide us through this year so that in 1 year, we will witness how the seeds of today have blossomed. Let this year be a time of preparation so that when you will grow in the next 100 years can take root. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, God is creative and self-giving, generously moving in all the near and distant corners of the universe. Nothing exists that does not find its source in God. Our first response to God's providence is gratitude. We sing thanksgiving. I invite you now to pause and recall a time when you have experienced blessing from this community of faith, from Pembina Parish, or from our denomination as a whole. Let us reflect with gratitude. For each one, we give thanks and praise. Gratitude is the foundation of generosity. And this morning, I am grateful for each one of you and for all of the members of our parish who together make up this small part of the body of Christ. I'm grateful as well for our denomination and the worship and work we have done together for the past 99 years. I pray that through our participation, through the sharing of our gifts of time and energy and resources, we might continue the work of the United Church of Canada wherever the Spirit leads us. If you would still like to make a donation to our parish or to M&S this morning, the donation plates are on the table by the door. As we offer all of ourselves and all of our gifts to God's good purposes for love and justice, let us offer them together with a paraphrase of the Lord's Prayer. I find it fascinating how in the United Church of Canada, each iteration of our expression of faith, whether it is from a version of the Lord's Prayer or whether it is a creed, we always keep the old ones and add the new ones, so it just keeps getting larger and larger and larger. And so I find this paraphrase to be a fascinating expansion on all of the places that we have been. Let us pray together. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe, the way of your justice be followed by peoples of the world, your heavenly will be done by all created beings, your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread that we need for today, feed us. In the hurts that we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. As we are sent out into the world to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly, we consider the work of our parish. I want to specifically remind folks this week that we are going to have the building closed on Wednesday? Oh dear. Thursday. Is it Thursday? 2 days this week. It's in your news and notes. We are closed. We're having the sanctuary and the foyer carpets cleaned this week. And so one of the days this week we are closed, I think it's Thursday. And then Friday is also, we are closed to mark Indigenous Peoples Day. So we want to make sure that you're aware of that. And if you need to come into the church to connect with Lori, who will be back in the office, or to talk with me, that you do that earlier in the week. I mean, you can always reach me in other ways too, but that's when the office will be open. Are there other announcements that need to be made today? I'll just mention that next Sunday we are marking Indigenous Day of Prayer, and after that we'll be entering into our summer worship schedule, and we're starting summer worship at St. Paul's this year on June 30th, and then summer worship at Zion Calvin will start in August. So just keep your eye on the stuff in news and notes if you want to know where church is. It will be starting at 10 o'clock, starting on the 30th, not next week. But on the 30th, we'll be starting worship at 10. And if you're ever confused, just give one of us a call at the office and we can make sure that you know when to arrive. We really want you to arrive. So it'll be good to start summer worship together. And that is why the chairs are in a slightly different arrangement in here as well. It brings us a bit closer together. It makes for much stronger singing. And with that in mind, let's sing our sending song, Voice United 420, Go to the World.
Hallelujah.
friends, as we go from this place, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you, and may the love of God flow over you and give you peace. Let us share the peace of Christ with one another as we go.